I got tagged in this tweet asking about generating values for a collection of columns to keep a track of who created or modified a table and when. What a great opportunity to dive into a little bit of Postgres and talk through some different options for how we might solve this. Let's get into it. So here I have a brand new Supabase project, which I'm going to use to test this out. If you don't have one of those, head over to our absolutely perfect domain, database.new, and follow the steps. Now we could use the table editor for this and create a table using Supabase's beautiful UI, but since we're talking through an SQL problem, let's use the SQL editor. Now we don't need to write all of this from scratch. We thankfully have the Supabase AI assistant to help us out. So let's say create a posts table with columns for created underscore at, created underscore by, updated underscore at, and updated underscore by. And this looks good, so let's accept that change. We can clean this up a little bit by removing these comments at the top, and we can use the type serial for our ID, meaning we don't need any of this. Our created at looks good. This is a timestamp with time zone. It's what we want. The created by is going to be a user, so this will be the user's ID. The type for that is UUID, and this one references the auth.users table and points to the ID column. Auth.users is a special Supabase table that keeps a track of all of the users and their sessions. So basically, the created by column will store the ID of a user who exists in the auth.users table. And then for updated by, we just want the same type and relationship to the auth.users table that we have for created by. So all of these columns will be automatically generated or managed by Supabase. So let's create one that the user will actually provide. So let's say a title for our post, which will be of type text. And let's click run to run that SQL against our Postgres database, and we see success, no rows returned, so running this statement succeeded. And now we have a table to store our posts in. So let's add another statement to insert into the posts table, and we're going to provide a title with the values set to my first post. Now, if we highlight over this insert statement, we can run just what's selected rather than the create table statement as well. And again, we see success, no rows returned. And if we write another statement to select star, so all of the columns from our post table and run just this select statement, we can see our new post, but our created and our updated columns are all null. But we don't really want the user to specify this as they're inserting a new row. They could just say they were anybody, and they will, because users can absolutely not be trusted. So let's take a look at how we can generate these columns automatically and ensure they can't be overwritten by the user. Let's look at the updated columns first, as they're a little bit more simple. And really, we only have one option to efficiently populate these columns when the user updates the row, and that's with a trigger function. So let's create a new query and use Supabase AI to create a trigger function that sets the updated underscore at and updated underscore by columns. And let's accept this change so we can clean it up a little bit again, remove these comments. We can put this on the same line. So it's create or replace function called update post. We might change this to say set updated columns. This could take some parameters, but I don't think we'll need it for this example. It's very important that this returns a trigger. And then we have as the body of this function. So that's everything between the dollar signs, and the language we're using is PLPGSQL. So this just gives us some program languagey things on top of SQL. So we can use if statements, while loops, declare variables, all of that alongside our SQL statements. So next I'm going to make it so that it's not shouting at me by making this lowercase, our begin and end. And then we want to set new.updated at equal to the result of the now function. So this just gives us back a timestamp. So this new variable represents the entire row for our post, and it's the new version. So whatever the user is trying to change it to. So we want to set the updated at column of that newly updated post to be the result of this now function. And then for new.updated by, we want this to be set to the current user, but the way we access that is with the auth.uid function. And lastly, we just want to make it not shout this return statement or that new variable. And now this function does exactly what we want. It'll add a timestamp for when this was updated, and it will set the updated by column to the user who's currently signed in. So let's run this one to create our Postgres function. And so let's create a trigger called on update set updated columns. We want this trigger to happen before the update action on the post table. And for each row within that statement, we want to execute the procedure or function set updated columns. So we can just copy this one from above. And we open and close that one, give it a semicolon, and then just highlight over this statement and run it against our Postgres database. And so now if we go back to our posts queries, we could add a new statement to update the post table and set the title column equal to the string updated post. And then anytime we're doing an update or delete, we need to make sure we add on a where clause. So it's only affecting the row where the ID is equal to 1. So this will be this post we created earlier. Now, super conveniently, we can actually run this SQL snippet on behalf of a specific user of our application. So this Postgres role, which is the default, is what the Supabase dashboard uses. So it has admin privileges. The anon role is when a user is not signed in, and the authenticated role allows us to impersonate a specific user. But we don't actually have any yet. So let's go over to the authentication tab, and then we can add a new user, and we want to create a new user for John at supabase.com, and then a super secure password. And we want to auto confirm this user because we're just using it for test purposes. So let's create that user, and we can create another one for Thor at supabase.com and another super secure password. And let's create that one. And now that we have these two users in our system, we can go back over to the SQL editor and change our role to the authenticated role and impersonate that John at supabase.com user. Now, anything we run in the SQL editor will be as if that specific user sent that query to the database. So this simulates sending this request from your application with this user signed in. It's a super handy way to test things are working the way you think they are without ever leaving the Supabase Studio. So let's run this update statement as our John at Supabase user. And we can see we successfully updated that row. So let's select all of our posts. And we can see we've updated that title, but our updated at and updated by columns have been automatically populated with the correct values, even though the only column we actually provided a value for was our title. An additional security benefit we get here is that the trigger is overriding that value, so the user isn't able to tinker with it. Again, we don't trust those dodgy users. So if John was to not just set the title to be this updated post, and maybe we'll make this something slightly different, like updated post again, and then they were to also set the updated by column to the ID of our Thor user. Now, when we run this one, it looks like everything has been updated successfully, but if we select all of our posts, we'll see the title has been successfully updated, but where we're expecting 5918 in the updated by column, we can see this is still 640F blah, 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 which is the ID of our currently signed in user, John. Security! All right, let's look at options for our created columns. Now we could do exactly the same thing with a trigger function, or we could use a default value on the column. Now number two sounds significantly simpler to me, and we already know how to do trigger functions. So let's look at default values. So let's set this back to our Postgres role because we want to be able to alter the structure of our table. So we want to alter our table posts, and then we want to alter our column for created underscore at and set the default value to be the result of that now function. We also want to alter the column created underscore by and set its default to the result of the auth.uid function. And now if we run this one, we see success, no rows returned. And since we want this logic to run when we actually create this post, let's delete from the post table where ID equals 1. And let's run this one. And Supabase is giving us a warning that this is a destructive operation. So let's run that destructive query. And I made a typo because this should be delete from posts. And we'll run that destructive query again. And we get success, no rows returned. So let's scroll up to our insert statement. And we shouldn't need to change anything. We only need to provide a title. But let's make sure we're running this as the authenticated role and impersonating our John at Supabase user. Now when we run this query and then select back all of our posts, we can see created at and created by have been automatically populated. But there's a problem. What about those dodgy users? When we're inserting a new post, if we also provide a value for created by, and again, let's set that to our Thor user. And again, let's run just this insert statement as our John user. And we see success, no rows returned. And when we select back all of our posts, we can see they've managed to override the value of created by because it's just a default value. It doesn't force that value if a user provides it. We can actually get around updated by as well by providing the value of our Thor user again. And if we run this insert query and then select all of our posts, we can see we got around that trigger we set up earlier because it only runs on update, not insert. Those damn hackers got us again. But the fix is easy. Let's head over to authentication and then policies and enable RLS or row level security on the post table. So let's click enable RLS and confirm, and we can see RLS is now enabled. So this automatically blocks any requests to select, insert, update, or delete. If we want to enable any of these actions, we just need to write a policy. So let's click new policy and we'll write this one from scratch. The policy name can be user can create their own posts. We want to enable the insert action. We'll leave the default as public. And then the expression we want to check is that the created underscore by column matches the ID of our currently signed in user. So we can get that with the auth.uid function. And then since we're creating a brand new record, it doesn't make sense for it to have been updated yet. So we can say, and the updated underscore by column is null. And if we scroll down, we can review, and this is the SQL that's been generated from those fields. We could actually copy and paste this directly into the SQL editor, but clicking save policy will also run this against our Postgres database. Great, so now the user will only be able to insert a post if the created by and updated by columns have not been tampered with. We also want to re-enable the select and update actions so we can test out each of these conditions. So let's create a new policy. Again, we'll do this from scratch. Our policy is going to make it so that the user can select all posts. This will be enabling the select action. Again, we want this to apply to the public role, which is the default. And then for the expression, we can just say true. So this will allow unrestricted read access to every post, which is what we want for this policy. So let's scroll down, review. This is the SQL. We can click save policy to run it. And now we have a policy for insert and select. So we just need to create one last policy from scratch. And we're going to make it so that a user can update posts. We want to enable the update action, again, the public role, and now we have a using and a with check expression. So if we just want to enable the update action for everyone, we can just put true as both of these expressions. Now this will work because our trigger function is ensuring the user can't tinker with those updated columns, but it would be better security practice to also back this up with an RLS policy. In case we decide to change that Postgres function down the line, we still want our database to reject those changes if the user's being dodgy. Those dodgy, dodgy users. So now that we want to check a specific condition, rather than just enabling the update action with the true value, let's talk about the difference between the using and with check expression. So performing an update can be thought of as two separate actions, selecting the current record from the database and then writing the updated version back to the database. So the using expression is checked against the state of the record before the updates, and the with check expression is checked against the updated version. So we don't really care about the state of the record before we make those changes, so we can leave this as true. We just want to make sure that the version that we're writing back to the database is in the same state as our trigger function. So we want to check that the updated underscore by column is equal to the result of the auth.uid function. So let's click review to see that SQL and then save policy to run it. And now back over in the SQL editor, if we change our role back to the authenticated role and impersonate our John user and then try to insert our post, tinkering with our created by column. So we'll get rid of updated by and this extra value for our Thor user. And if we run this one, we see new row violates row level security policy for table posts. And then if we instead make this updated by and run it with our Thor user, we get that same error. But if we do the right thing and try to insert a new post specifying just the title column, and we run this one, we get success, no rows returned, because we're not doing anything dodgy. And if we select our posts, so we can see some of their IDs, and we'll take this ID 7 and try to update posts, setting the title to updated post again, and trying to maliciously set our updated by column to our Thor user, where the ID is 7, and we run this one, we'll see success, no rows returned. But if we select all of our posts, we can see our post with ID 7 still has its updated by column set to null. So just like regular update or delete statements, Postgres will run this statement on whichever rows it can, but in this case, there were no rows that it could run on because of RLS. So it's still got our back. And lastly, if we try to update that post in the correct way by only giving it a title and we run this statement, we see the same message, success, no rows returned. But if we select all of our posts, we can see not only has the title been updated, but we have the correct updated at and updated by fields automatically populated for us. So as you can see, RLS policies are an extremely powerful and secure way to implement authorization rules at the database layer. If you want to go deeper with RLS, I recommend you check out this video right here, where we go a little bit deeper on the theory and build up to an advanced policy that's enforcing rules from other tables. But until next time, keep building cool stuff.